How to Succeed in Physics. Basically, just an introduction to General Physics 1. So when you were taking physics before, did you imagine working through difficult equations, memorizing formulas that seem to have no real use in life outside the physics classroom, no? So ginahambal, or when I had my classes in physics, no, some students commented na, sure ka na, mugi sa formulas, din taman ni magamit in real life. So did you already, did you also experience that kind of thinking, or did you also thought of that? Too many formulas, but then you're quite unsure where will you use it. Many people come to the subject of physics with a bit of fear. So I hope that you don't have fear to the subject. But as you begin exploring this broad-ranging subject, you may soon realize that physics plays a much larger role in our lives than our first thoughts, no matter your life goals or career choices may be. In one of the performance tasks we did in Physics 1 last year, there was this student who commented na, physics is really awesome because they get to understand how things work around them. So basically, physics try to study on those concepts. So what is physics? Well, physics is concerned with describing the interactions of energy. First, energy. We have matter, space, and time. Excuse me. So those are the things that we try to understand. Just try, because you can really not fathom the vastness of the universe. But whatever is within our reach, we try to understand them in the realm of physics, especially interested in what fundamental mechanisms underlie every phenomenon. So for example, how do we get airplanes to fly? How do we move? Why does things fall? Why do things float? What else? The integrity of buildings is also understood in physics. How we build things and how we deconstruct things. So we can all do that when we learn more about physics. How do we succeed in physics? As what I'm telling to my students in physics, it all lies in practice. So you can never get to be better, you can never be better in something when you don't practice. They say practice makes perfect, but it's not true because, again, nobody's perfect, diba? Hambal nyo man na. But what I believe is that practice makes progress. So when you practice and practice, you will have progress as you do the practice. So keep in mind, in studying physics, first we need to make a note here about the relationship between your study habits and physics education. So do you study, or you just sit around and wait for someone to give you answers when you have tests? So as you work your way through the course, each chapter will build upon the last. In physics, for example, our lessons in chapter 1 has something to do with the lessons in chapter 2, chapter 3, chapter 4, chapter 5, and so on. And actually, your lessons way back in junior high school has something to do as well with what we are going to learn in physics 1 and even in physics 2. So keep in mind that in each chapter, it will have something to do with the next chapter. So hindi gid pwede nga subong nga chapter mambal ka, ay wala ko kaintindi, I will just make bawit to the next chapter. That could not happen, or that's quite impossible, because again, each chapter is built upon the last chapter, especially the basic skills and fundamental concepts. If you do not keep up in the beginning, you will be in serious trouble by the middle of the class, because you will have no foundation for learning the new material by the time you get to the final exam. I may video. Sandali. Okay. Going back. That's what I've said earlier. You need to keep up in each chapter. You cannot just let some chapters slide off because each chapter is important to the next. For example, in the first quarter, chapter 2, okay ka. Chapter 3, medyo, semp lang. And then chapter 4 comes. You cannot expect yourself to really perform well on the next chapter, on chapter 4, because in chapter 3, you did not understand anything. And by the time you get to quizzes and exams, you'll be completely lost. And we don't want that to happen. So what should you do? No, thinking that each chapter is built on the last one. So if you study, so here's a graph, time spent and progression through quarters. So I hope you know how to interpret graphs. Anyway, so you have there on the y-axis, time spent studying. So as you go higher in that axis, mas nagataas ang imong time spent in studying. And then sa x-axis, amo nang imong progress in the lesson. So if in the beginning, you just spend a little time, and then in the last part, dira kayo mabaka-baka tuon, doon mo man ang gakatabo mo, di ba? Before the exam, dira nyo ginabubutanan nga pag tuon. Is that right? Moments before the exam or even a night before the exam. Can I hear responses from the audience? Hello? Nga kung wala pa-exam, silang. Pero kung exam na buwas, di ka ko palang ibubo na nan nga pagtuon. So that won't work as presented in our slide. Na hindi pwede nga sa sugod gamay lang imo time, so sa ulihi ka na lang yung mabaka-baka tuon. Na abri mo, imo progress ma, masigi man imo progress. So that's quite a dream. So that won't work. So ano gi dapat, no? Consistent time of studying will keep you progressing in this subject. What I mean is that, iniman, I don't mean na every day gid ka mo ma-study, no? What I mean is that you allot enough time consistently to practice to practice your skills and concepts in physics. So you should aim to study like that. Because when you study like that, you have consistent study time in physics or practice time, you get to progress in the subject. But here's another one. If you're diligent at the beginning, so grabe gyud tuon mo sa sugo, that will work. No? Time spent at the beginning is very, not really very big or considerably higher than the average. And when you progress through the quarter, you can just spend smaller study time or practice time. Because, di ba, sa ginambal ta kagina, each chapter is built on the last chapter. If you have very strong foundations, if you have a solid foundation, then you'll probably end up studying like that. Because it will be much easier for you to understand things when you understand the basic concepts and fundamental skills in physics. So what you need when you study physics? One, you need your equations. You need as many equations as there are unknowns. So, for example, if there are two unknowns, how many equations will you need? Very good, Denise. No? So, ginambal ganun, you need as many equations as there are unknowns. So, if you have two unknowns, you will need two equations. If you have five unknowns, then you will most likely have or need five equations. Units. Do not forget your units. Units should be analyzed algebraically. Usually, or most of the time, some students get wrong marks because they leave units out of the picture or salang ila pag-cancel sang units, or in the final answer, there was no units indicated. Always think of units as part of your solutions and problems, of course. Next, vectors. Most of the time, we'll be learning about different kinds of vectors and operate in vectors. So when you have problem involving vectors, we should always break them down. So you will learn more about vectors when we really go into the lessons in the weeks to come. And of course, variables. Make sure that you know what every variable represents. For example, what variable is being represented by the Greek letter alpha or letter A? Do you know what variable is that? Anyone? Letter A. Ano ang gina-represent sina nga variable? No one? So in physics, the representations of variable may vary from convention to convention. But we have commonly used variables and representations. For example, so what I've said, A is used to represent acceleration. How about V? What is V used for? Small letter V. So small letter V, velocity. Kung big letter V, kung capital V, bigger velocity. Kung bigger V, so you have volume. You also have voltage. No? So dapat aware ka kung ano ang context ng problem mo and what does every variable represent. X, what does X mean? What's the variable X in physics? So X is, anyone may idea kung ano ang X na variable? So X, wala may masabag. X is your distance or displacement in the X axis. Yes, position, that's very good. X can also be represented as Y if it's in the Y axis. In physics, these four things are very important that you understand them for you to be able to progress through this course. So let's proceed. Physics is more than just math. It's a lot of math, but it's more than math. I think it's also quite safe to say that when you learn physics, it's quite harder than pure math because you need to integrate science concepts into mathematical equations, or the other way around. You need to understand science concepts through representing them in numbers or through mathematical equations. Connecting math to real world concepts will help you not just in physics, but also in any pursuit that requires mathematical thinking. In any case, it's crucial to making physics easy and intuitive and cutting your workload considerably. It's not also healthy for you to excessively practice and study because you'll deteriorate instead of progressing. I mean, we don't want you to be exhausted in studying physics. And remember, hindi lang physics in yung tunan. So you just need to set a considerable amount of time and consistent practice for it. So let's start with our math concepts. No? First, of course, the significant figures, which we already discussed in your general chemistry 1, right? So just a review. It's important to recognize and report the limitations of measurement along with the magnitude and unit of measurement. When we say significant figures, these are numbers that possess value in the number that is being represented or the quantity that is being represented. Many times, the measurement made in an experiment are analyzed for regularities. So since the reported numbers show the limits of the measurement, how specific these measurements really are, it's possible to determine how regular these measurements are. So basically, in a physical quantity, certain numbers hold value or hold position in that quantity. And the rest of the numbers are just placeholders or are not significant. So what are these significant figures? So can anyone share what are these numbers that are significant? Anyone? Non-zero numbers, very good. Non-zero numbers are all significant. What else? Non-zero numbers lang. Mayo pa ang non-zero number significant, ano? Zeros in between non-zero numbers, very good. Zeros between two non-zero digits are significant. Wow, namatiin sila sa chemistry one. So that's right. The first item when we learn about significant figures. Of course, one, all non-zero digits are significant. So what are the non-zero digits? Yeah, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So those are non-zero digits. Next, all zeros between non-zero digits are significant. So tanan nga zero, sa tunga sang duha ka non-zero, giniligay nun ko lang, are all significant. All beginning zeros are not significant. And ending zeros are significant if the decimal point is written in, but not significant if the decimal point is an understood decimal or wala siya gin explicitly nga ginbota. The decimal point is not written in. So, the first one, all non-zeros are significant. So, how many significant figures are there in the first digits or the first figure? 543. How many significant figures? Oh, kamang alam. So it's 3 significant figures. Very good. No, kinanglan tapo mag-review. Wow, smart. Yes, Denise, smart. How about the second one? 22.437. Very good again. 5 significant figures. How about the third one? 1.321754. How many significant figures? Pepila ni Be. There are 7 significant figures. May mga nagsabat 8 ba sinasala lang isip? Ano? But there are 7 significant figures. Yep. 1, 3, 2, 1, 7, 5, 4. So you have 7 significant figures. So all non-zero digits are significant. Next, all zeros between non-zero digits are significant. So kung ang tanan nga zero, sa punga sang 2 non-zero digits are all significant. So how many significant figures are there in the first figure or in the first digits? The 7,004. So there are 4 significant figures. How about the second one? 10.3002. There are 6 significant figures. How about the third one? So big. Third one, you have 3 significant figures. Wow! Namatiin sila sa klase sa chem. Next, all beginning zeros are not significant. So how many significant figures are there in the first item? Basi ang iban, gabantay lang dasang comments ang iban, dasang ma comment man, sang same number. Wow. Kadlaw mo, Vince. So there are 2 significant figures. As much as possible, practice, no? Okay, how do you succeed in physics, Gani? It all lies in practice. How about the second one? How many significant figures? one significant figure. The third item, there are four significant figures. Now, mga estudyante, hindi nga hindi pagasanag. Anyway, it's fine. Next, ending zeros are significant if the decimal point is actually written in, but not significant if the decimal point is an understood decimal. So how many significant figures are there in 37.300? How many significant figures? Oh, apat na nagsabat tao. How many significant figures in 37.300? There are five significant figures. Hambal gani, di ba? Ending zeros are significant if my decimal point is actually written. So my decimal point, right? 37.300. So there are five significant figures. Okay, my decimal point. What if wala decimal point? Ang 37300. How many significant figures na lang? There will be only three. Next, how about the next item? How many significant figures? How many significant figures? There are seven significant figures. Saliwat. Trailing zeros with a decimal point are significant. The last one, how many significant figures? How many significant figures ang last? So may gambal 3, may gambal 1. So ilagay. There are three significant figures. Hambal gani. Kung ginsulat ang decimal point, na malusot ka pa, Harv. If there's a decimal point, if the decimal point is actually written, then all of the figures or all zeros will be, all trailing zeros, I mean, will be significant. So more examples. How many significant figures? The first one. 1, very good. 1 significant figure. How about the second item? There are 3 significant figures. And the last one, there are 5. Well, very good. You already understood. Well, you already understood before this, but at least we get to review your concepts in significant figures. Subong mo lang na-understand, Harvey. Ako balay mo, teacher, sa significant figures. Anami, kid. Anyway, let's proceed. So in significant figures, we now know how to identify significant figures. Now, let us understand how do we operate when we take into consideration significant figures. So when you add numbers, considering significant figures, the answer to an addition or subtraction operation must not have any digits further to the right than the shortest addend. In other words, the answer should have as many decimal places as the addend with the smallest number of decimal places. So when you add or subtract numbers, pila dapat ka decimal places or significant figures ang imong final answer. So as stated there, your final answer should have the same number of decimal places as the one with the smallest number of decimal places in the addends or in the numbers that you're operating with. For example, addition. So 13.3843 centimeters plus 1.012 centimeters plus 3.22 centimeters is all equal to 17.6163 centimeters. So what should be your final answer? What should be your final answer? Your final answer should be 17.62. Approximately 17.62 centimeters. Why? Because again, when you add or subtract figures, you need to follow nga may mga gainuba na this. You need to follow the smallest decimal figure or the smallest number of decimal places. So for example, in your figures na gin-operate, in your figures na gin-operate, you have 3.32 or 2 as the one with the smallest figures or the smallest decimal places, I mean. So you should follow that in your final answer, which would be 17.62. Okay. The 3-man significant smallest. Yes, 3 ang significant, 3 ang smallest number of significant figures. But when you add or when you subtract, you follow the least number of decimal places. That is when you add or subtract. You do not follow the number of significant figures, but the number of decimal places. So sa tatlo, pila ang may pinakanubo na decimal places? It's 2. So your final answer should be approximately 17.62. Next, when you multiply and divide, so the answer for a multiplication or division operation must have the same number of significant figures as the factor with the least number of significant figures. So, dire naman, when you multiply and divide, you will follow the least number of significant figures. Example, if you multiply 3.556 times 2.4 centimeters is equal to 8.5344 centimeters squared. Again, do not forget your units, huh? So, what should be your final answer? Wala namin nagsabat. What should be your final answer? Oh, si Kate nag-answer kay si Ismael, wala unit. Sala na nga daan. What should be the final answer? So the final answer should be 8.5 centimeter squared. Why? Because you need to follow the least number of significant figures. And in the figures that you're operating, for 3.556 has 4 significant figures, while 2.4 has 2. So, di na mas na boss. Siyempre ang 2. So, you follow the least one, which is 2. The final answer should be approximately. Dapat may approximately na tagali. Apologies. Approximately 8.5 centimeters squared. Another example, 20.0 times 5.0000 is equal to 100.00000 centimeters squared. What should be your final answer? What should be your final answer? Now, answering 1.00 is incorrect. You should have 1.00 with a decimal point. Because without the decimal point, kung 1.00 lang, you will only get how many significant figures? We only get 1. And we need 3 significant figures for our final answer. Another one, you have 5.444 centimeters times 22 centimeters is equal to 119.768 centimeters squared. What should be your final answer? Your final answer should be 120 centimeters squared. Very good. Wala decimal point, Vince. Because when you place a decimal point, you get how many significant figures? You'll get 3. But as what our figures in our operation tells us, you should only have 2. Questions about significant figures. Wow, slide 51 pa lang ta. So more of our, the things that we will be discussing today are more of review for you to be able to face physics with confidence. No? So next we have scientific notation, if there are no questions in significant figures. So what is a scientific notation? What is a scientific notation? Where do we use it? And why do we use it? A very participative kay Harvey. As mentioned by Harvey, we use scientific notation kung large ang number. So use scientific notation para ma-shorten. Plus 5. No? Plus 5 sa diin. Or very small. Yes, that's correct, Samantha. So in physics, we deal with very large numbers and very small numbers because we study objects as small as subatomic particles and as large as galaxies. So it should be clear that physicists deal with these kinds of numbers. So for example, the mass of a lead atom is 0.00, lots of zeros, 3-4 grams. That's an extremely small number. And extremely large numbers, just like the distance from our galaxy to Andromeda galaxy, which is 2.5 million light years away, which is approximately 25, lots of zeros, kilometers. So imagine if you are operating in that, or you are operating with those kinds of numbers, you will have to write lots of zeros. No, malibat ka, masala ka pa karon isip. When I'm dealing with these kinds of numbers. So that is where scientific notations come in. We shorten them for us to have more convenience when we write and calculate them, but still preserving the value of the numbers. So how do we write 0. Lots of zeros, 34 grams, and 25 lots of zeros, kilometers in scientific notation. Naisip niyo da kung pila ka zeros, nalibat ka na. So that's the problem there. If we deal with these kinds of numbers, we are more prone to errors. And we don't want to have errors as much as possible. So for example, we have this one. So sala na di ako na answer out. So how many zeros are there? You have 1, 3, 6, 9, 12, 15, 18, 21, 22. Na 34 na daw ni butang mas. So the correct answer should be 3.4 times 10 raised to negative 22 dapat. Because when you count, how do you convert small numbers into scientific notation? So you just count how many decimal places are you moving from. So since the decimal places is in the beginning part or in the first part, So how many places will you move? You move 22 places. And take note that significant or scientific notations should only have one non-zero digit number before your decimal place. Next. How about this one? What's the scientific notation? Is it A, B, C, or D? So the correct answer should be A, positive exponent. When do you use positive exponents? You use positive exponents if you move. Excuse me. If you move the decimal place to the right. Right to the right, to the left. So that's your positive. If you have the negative exponent, when you move your decimal places going to the right. Basically, pag positive ang exponent, buot silingon, dako ang number. Kung negative ang exponent, gamay ang number. So a number is expressed in scientific notation by moving the decimal so that exactly one, again, one non-zero digit is on the left of the decimal, and the exponent of 10 will be the number of the places the decimal was moved. If the decimal is moved to the left, not to the left, your exponent is positive. And when you move it to the right, then your exponent is negative. All significant figures are maintained in the scientific notation. So, ang tanan yung significant figures, dapat ara sa scientific notation. To express this number in scientific notation, what will be the scientific notation of, what's this, 13,700,000,000? What's the scientific notation? So it's 1.37 times 10 raised to 10. Again, all significant figures should be reflected in your scientific notations. So, you have, what are your significant figures there? You have 1, 3, and 7. So, all of them should be there. Unless it's instructed that you round it off. Next. Express this number in scientific notation. What's the scientific notation of that number? So it will be 7.4 times 10 raised to negative 17. Because you moved 17 places to the right as you have your decimal place in between 7 and 4. Express the number 8.43 times 10 raised to 5 in expanded form. So what's the expanded form of 8.43 times 10 raised to 5? It will be 843,000. You did not just add five zeros. OK? okay? You need to move the decimal places. So since may duwa ka ka decimal place kang i-move sa 4 at sa 3, so basically, matatlo ka na lang ka move. So you add 3 zeros. Very good. Now, when we operate significant figures, of course, because some figures are insignificant, are in scientific notation, and when we calculate, we use these scientific notations in our equations. So in order to add or subtract numbers in scientific notations, the exponents must be the same. You cannot add or subtract scientific notations if their exponents are not the same, just like in fractions. Now, for you to add or subtract fractions, you need to have the same denominator. If the exponents are not the same, one of the numbers must be changed so that the exponents are the same. So how do you change the number, or how do you change the exponent? You just move again. Either you move to the left or to the right and then change the exponent so that both of your scientific notations will have the same exponents. Once the exponents are the same, the numbers are then added, and then you just copy the exponent. So for example, when you add 5.0 times 10 raised to 5 and 4.0 times 10 raised to 4, what should be the answer? Is it A? Is it B? Is it C? Or is it D? No, basta yung ibang calculator lang da. So again, first, dapat, ano gani? We should make our exponents the same. Since the exponent of the first figure is 5, and the exponent of the second figure is 4, then you cannot add them. First, you need to make the exponent same. So how? So we can change 4.0 times 10 raised to 4 into 5. How? So paano gani i-increase ang exponent? You move it to the left or right? How do you increase the number of exponent? Do you move to the left or do you move to the right? Left, right, left, right, right. So you move to the, how do you move to the left. Pag move mo sa left, maging 0.40 times 10 raised to 5. So when that happens, pag 0.40 times 10 raised to 5 na siya, they have the same exponents already. So you can just add your coefficients, which is 0.4 and 5.0, you'll get 5.4. And then you just copy your base, or 10 raised to 5. Next, multiply. So when you multiply, what will you do? Multiply 5.0 times 10 raised to 5 and 4.0 times 10 raised to 4. What will be the answer? Is it A, B, C, or D? What would be the answer? So Jonathan and Jan Ayan and a lot of you answered C. So what do you do when you multiply? What's the answer if you multiply 5.0 times 10 raised to 5 and 4.0 times 10 raised to 4? The answer is A. YA. Remember that Scientific notations should only have one digit before the decimal place. So, check to man inyo ginbuhat na you just multiply the coefficients 5 and 4. So, 5.0 times 4.0 is 20. But then, so 20, and then what will you do with the exponent? You add your exponent. So you have 5 and 4. 5 plus 4 is equal to 9. So basically what you have is 20.0 times 10 raised to 9. But your coefficient is 20. And that could not be your final answer, because scientific notation should only have one figure before, or one digit before, your decimal place. So you need to move your decimal place closer to number 2, and that will increase your exponent by 1, since you only move 1. So your final answer should be 2.0 times 10 raised to 10. Next, multiply 6.0 times 10 raised to 3 and 2.0 times 10 raised to negative 5. Is it A, B, C, or D? So what's the answer? Brain error. I'd really love to see your faces, but your videos are turned off. So anyway, what's the answer? The answer is letter D. The answer is letter D, Y. Again, diba, when we multiply scientific notations, we just multiply your coefficients, which is 6.0 and 2.0, and we get 12. Now, your 12 is your coefficient now. Then what do you do with your exponents? You add them. So basically, it's 3 plus negative 5. And 3 plus negative 5 will give you negative 2. So that is 12.0 times 10 raised to negative 2. Now, 12 has two digits before, or your coefficient has two digits before the decimal place. So you need again to move the decimal place. So 1, or move it closer to 1. And then you get to increase your exponent. So since it's negative 2, when you increase it, it becomes negative 1. It does not become negative 3. So your final answer is 1.2 times 10 raised to negative 1, or you can just write it as 1. As 0.12. Correct? As 0.12. If you just write it, since negative 1 man lang ang exponent, so what do you do? How do you express it in standard form? Your 1.2 times 10 raised to negative 1. That's 0.12. Very good, Denise. That is 0.12 or 0.12. Next, divide 6.0 times 10 raised to 3 and 2.0 times 10 raised to negative 5. What's the answer? Is it A, B, C, or D? So it's also similar with your when you operate or when you multiply scientific notations. What will be the answer if you divide 6.0 times 10 raised to 3 by 2.0 times 10 raised to 5? The correct answer is for the others, I really encourage you to practice. The correct answer is B. Why B? So when we divide exponents, we just go on with the division with our coefficients, which is 6.0 and 2.0. So 6.0 divided by 2.0 is 3, right? So 3, you have 3.0. And then, what will you do with the exponents? You subtract them. So it's 3 minus negative 5. So when you subtract a negative number, what do you do? 3 minus negative 5, you add them instead. So 3 minus negative 5 becomes 3 plus 5. And that becomes 8. So your final answer will be 3.0 times 10 raised to 8. So that's it for scientific notations and significant figures. Questions? We're halfway already. Harina, math na. Not really hard math, but just basic math. For you to be able to understand and push through our lessons in physics. So do you have questions in significant figures and scientific notations? If none, then we can proceed with the math concepts. So again, in physics, most of our lessons are integrated or are described in mathematical equations. So it's important for you to be able to understand math concepts. So of course, your fundamental algebra, which is learned since grade 7, do you still remember your FOIL method? So of course, your FOIL method, when you operate binomials, you multiply your first digits or your first variables in both of your binomials, then the outside, and then the inside, and then the last. So that is your FOIL method. You need to remember that in our physics class. And of course, your properties, no? Mathematical properties. You have distributive property of equations. You have A multiplied by the quantity of B plus C is equal to AB plus AC, because you can just distribute A to B and C. So A times quantity B plus C, or parenthesis, when they are enclosed in parenthesis, you can just distribute A. So A times B and A times C. So that will be equal to AB plus AC. Also, negative quantity of B plus A is equal to, you can also distribute the negative, because that also means negative 1 times the quantity of B plus A. So that becomes negative B minus A. Associative property. So you have A plus B plus C, or A plus the quantity of B plus C is also the same, or will also, or is equal to the quantity of A plus B plus C. Commutative property, or commutative property, A plus B is equal to B plus A. So basically, 1 plus 2 is equal to 2 plus 1. And 1 times 2 is equal to 2 times 1, or your A times B is equal to B times A. So these are just basic concepts in algebra. Fraction math. This is important because in our equations, we most likely have fractions, or when we operate with variables, we do not use, I forgot the term that we used to call the dot line dot, again, so the division symbol. Instead, we use a line bar, or the fraction symbol. So you have, first in our item, we have A plus B all over C. So that is also equal to A over C plus B over C. So if you have an equation na A over C plus B over C, if your denominators are the same, then you can just proceed with adding your numerator, sir. So A plus B all over C. Just copy the denominator. Next, what if you don't have the same denominators? Just like X over Y plus A over B. What you could do is just do what? You cross multiply. So you have here the numerator of the first fraction, which is X. You multiply it with the denominator of the second fraction, which is B. So you have XB plus the numerator of your second fraction times the denominator of the second fraction, which is AY, all over the product of your two denominators. So X over Y plus A over B is equal to X plus B plus AY over YB. Are you still following? Naintindihan niyo man? Naintindihan niyo man? Okay. Next. A, B, C, D divided by A, D is equal to B, C. But it's not the same. A, B, C, D is not the same as A plus B plus C plus D because that's different. A, B, C, D means A times B times C times D. While the other one, A plus B plus C plus D. When you have over AD, you cannot cancel out in the second one, ang A plus B plus C plus D over AD. You cannot cancel A and B because their operation is addition. No? But for the other one, it's the first one, it's multiplication. So you can cancel them out or you can omit them since A plus B plus C plus D divided by AD, so A cancel, D cancel, you're left with B, C. But when you have A plus B plus C plus D, you cannot cancel them. So that's not equal to B, C. Next, A over B divided by C over D will be equal to AB times DC. Or when you have to divide two fractions, you just get the reciprocal of your divisor and you multiply it with your dividend. You just get the reciprocal or sulion mo lang, and then you just multiply it with the other fraction. Next, negative A over B is also equal to A over negative B, which is also equal to negative A over B. Okay, I hope you understood fraction math. Any questions about fraction? This is really important, especially when you operate with equations. Remember that in physics, you will need to transpose or you need to transform, I mean, the equation in which it will lead you to the right variable. Next, so in operating with equations, no, especially when you have two or more equations, one way to resolve them is through substitution. Well, you can use elimination, but most of the time, we will be using substitution method in coming up with the correct variable or with the correct answer. So in substitution method, we rearrange one equation and plug the result into the second equation. So this is most easily seen as an example. So let's take these equations. So 5x plus 4y is equal to 19, and x minus y is equal to 2. For example, those are your equations. When we learn physics, those x and y's are just replaced with more specific variables. For example, speed, time, acceleration, work, energy. They are all just the same. They are variables. So 5x plus 4y equals 19 is our first equation. And our second equation is x minus y is equal to 2. So in substitution, again, we need to transform one equation so that we can plug it in. Either we just leave x in one side of the equation or y. So which of the equations will you transform? din sa mga equation ang imo i-transform. Is it the first equation or the second equation? So actually, you can transform the first one or the second one. But it will be much easier for you if you transform the simpler equation, which is, the simpler equation is x minus 2 is equal to 1. So that's the simpler equation. So when you rearrange the equation, let's rearrange for the value of x. What will be the equation if we rearrange x minus 2 is x minus y is equal to 2? What will be the equation if we rearrange it for x? It will be x is equal to 2 plus y na pinalagpat sa 2y. Nga aman. When you transform the equation, di ba? For x, when we arrange for x, we want x to be left on one side of the equation. Pero may upod siya nga negative y. So, paano ito na siya dulaon? Of course, to take out negative y, you just need to add y. So, kung ma-add ka di plus y sa isa ka side, syempre ma-add ka man sa pia plus y. So, sa left-hand side of the equation, x minus y plus y, you'll get x. Sa left-hand side, sa right-hand side of the equation, you have 2 plus y. So, that will give you x is equal to 2 plus y. Or, to make it easy, you can just transpose, no? Transpose. So when you transpose or when you leave x in one side of the equation, you have minus y, right? So x minus y. So when you transpose that to the other side, it becomes plus y. So x is equal to 2 plus y. It's also the same as x is equal to y plus 2. Parehas lang na sila. X is equal to 2 plus y, and x is equal to y plus 2. So now we have a rearranged equation. Now, we know that x is equal to 2 plus y. Now we can plug that in to the first equation where x is. Diba going back, balanta nga x is equal to 2 plus y. So first equation, we have 5x plus 4y is equal to 19. You have there the variable x, and you can replace this variable x to this value in your second equation because you know that x is equal to 2 plus y. So when you plug that in this first equation, what will be our equation now? What should our equation look like now? The entire equation. So our equation will now be, so isolute mo lang na da, ay since x is equal to 2y, you get 5. Ang x, i-replace mo sa 2 plus y. So 5, quantity of 2 plus y plus 4y is equal to 19. Now, our equation only has how many variables? Pila na lang variables sa sulod sang first equation? Nagin plug in nato ng second equation. How many variables? Itchy, very good. So there is only one variable left. And in an equation, when you have one variable, you get to operate it. You get to simplify it. So what will be, or moving forward, what will be our equation now? If you have 5, quantity of 2 plus y plus 4y is equal to 19. Y will be equal to what number? Y will be equal to what number? our y will be equal to. Ga practice man kamo. Again, this session is for you to be able to practice again and to refresh your skills and concepts in math and basic concepts in physics so that when we start with our classes in physics 1, you will have relatively easier way around. Grabe, may X na dayon. Why lang, Danay? So our Y will be, Denise is correct. Y will be equals to 1. How? Diba plug in natin ang 2 plus Y in our X variable. So we get 5 times the quantity of 2 plus Y plus 4Y is equal to 19. Diba? Distributive property. Since ali enclosed siya sa parenthesis, so you can distribute it. So 5 times 2 is 10. 5 times y, positive 5 times positive y is plus 5 or positive 5y, correct? And then copy plus 4y equals 19. So combine like terms. Like terms mo is 5y and 4y. So positive 5y plus positive 4y is 9y. So your equation now is 10 plus 9y is equal to 19. Now, we just need 9y to be left on one side of the equation. So we need to get rid of the 10 na upod niya. So how do you get rid of that? We are going to transpose it. So you have positive 10. Malumpat siya sa equal sign, it becomes what? It becomes minus 10. So your equation becomes 9y is equal to 19 minus 10. And 19 minus 10 is, of course, 9. So your equation becomes 9y is equal to 9. So 9y is equal to 9. Dapat y lang atong ginapangita, not 9y. So how do you get rid of 9 beside y? You do not transpose it in a way nga it becomes y is equal to 9 minus 9. It does not work that way. Because 9y means 9 times y is equal to 9. So how do you get rid of 9 in 9 times y? You divide both sides by 9. So 9y over 9 and 9 over 9. So 9y over 9, we have y. And 9 over 9, we have 1. Therefore, y is equal to 1. So now we know what y is. And y is equal to 1. But that's just y. We need to know the x. So since sa atin nga first equation, sa atin nga equations, ang second equation mas simpler siya, we can just substitute the figure y and that becomes, since y is equal to 1, so x minus y is equal to 2. So x minus 1 is equal to 2. So if x minus 1 is equal to 2, x is equal to 2, x is equal to what? X is equal to 3. Because, di ba dapat X lang bilhin sa isa ka side sa equation? So how do you get rid of negative or minus 1 in X minus 1? So you just add both sides by 1. So X minus 1 plus 1 and 2 plus 1. So X is equal to 3. So what are the value of our variables? X is equal to 3 and y is equal to 1. Can you check your answer if it's correct? How do you check your answer if it's correct? You just need to substitute both of the values in your or in any of the equation. So let's take, for example, the first equation. If x is equal to 3 and y is equal to 1 according to our solutions or answers, is it equal to 19? So yes, it is equal to 19. 5 times 3, 5 times x is 3. So 5 times 3 is 15. And then 4 times 1, since y is equal to 1, you have 4. So 15 plus 4 is equal to 19. So that's for substitution. Next, we move to trigonometry. Trigonometry is important in the study of physics because we'll be dealing with directions. And directions are expressed in terms of angles. The trigonometry is the mathematics of right triangles, which are triangles with a 90-degree angle. This is important, or just the mathematics of triangles. This is important to realize because we will always want to deal with right triangles, and usually these must be constructed, often by inserting lines artificially, in order to use the tools presented in this part of the session. So there are two major concepts that we will need to be familiar with when we learn or when we study physics. One, your trigonometric functions, which are your sine, cosine, and tangent, and the Pythagorean theorem. So let's start with the trigonometric functions sine, cosine, and tangent. What mnemonic can you remember when we speak of sine, cosine, and tangent? So it's soh with an H, ka with an H, and toa. Remember that all angles inside a triangle must always add up to 180. All interior angles of a triangle is equal to 180. So when we calculate vectors, you will understand more about vectors when you go through your physics classes already. Triangles will keep popping out. So it's important that you know that. So as you have mentioned, you have the SOHATOA is the mnemonic by which most people remember their or our trigonometric functions. It tells us which trig function correspond to what ratio of sides in the right triangle. So what does SOHATOA mean? In our triangle, we have the reference angle, and then we have the opposite side, the adjacent side, and the hypotenuse. So what does SOHATOA mean? So you have the SO, the KA, and the TOA. In SO, or the first one, what is the trigonometric function used? What's the trig function for the first one, for SOH? It's sine. And what's the formula for sine? When you have sine as your trig function. Remember that you always have the angle. It's not just opposite over hypotenuse. It's sine theta is equal to opposite over hypotenuse. So for SOH, your trig function is sine, and your formula is sine theta. Theta means what? What does theta mean? Anyone? What does theta mean in the equation? So theta means angle. How do you spell theta? It's T-H-E-T-A. So the sine of the angle will be equal to opposite over hypotenuse. For the second one, ka, what's the trig function? The trig function is cosine. And your formula is? What's your formula? So the formula is cosine. Well, advance si Chini. Wala pa kalabot sa tangent. But, well, anyway, that's correct. So your cosine theta is your adjacent over hypotenuse. There. And of course, your toa is your tangent, and tangent theta is opposite over adjacent. So those are your trigonometric functions. You can also say it na sokatoa or sokatoa to remember it very well. So these are your three trigonometric functions, which should be commonly used when we go through our lessons in physics. To remember always the formula, and remember also how to transform equations. Now, in order to extract the angle, remember na this formulas here, this equations, sine theta is equal to opposite over hypotenuse. When you have theta, or if you want to solve for the theta, what will your equation look like? Kung gusto mo isolve ang theta, let's say sine, in this equation, sine theta is equal to opposite over hypotenuse. What will be your equation if you're going to solve for theta? What's the formula? Anyone? If you're going to solve for theta. Anyone here? Do you know how to transform the equation? So your equation should be, theta. Your equation should be theta is equal to the inverse sine of opposite over hypotenuse. Or theta is equal to sine, inverse sine, opposite over hypotenuse. So it should be like that, inverse sine. And for you to cancel sine theta in one side, you need to multiply it with its inverse. And you will do that on the other side as well. How about if you need to solve for the hypotenuse? Or let's say cosine theta is equal to adjacent over hypotenuse. How will you solve for your hypotenuse? How will you solve for hypotenuse? So remember that when you have the operation is division, for you to cancel it, you just need to multiply both sides of that expression that you need to take out. So if you are to solve for hypotenuse, in cosine theta is equal to adjacent over hypotenuse, what will be the equation? Your equation should be hypotenuse will be equal to what? Anybody here? Are you still alive? What will be your equation? If you are to solve for hypotenuse, what will be your equation for cosine theta is equal to adjacent over hypotenuse? Ano ang equation kung h ang imo pangitaon? Kung madugayan ka mo sa amo pa lang ng equation, you really need to practice yourselves. Kami mga squared-squared na kamukhaw. So for you to solve for hypotenuse, di ba cosine theta is equal to adjacent over hypotenuse. For cosine theta is equal to adjacent over hypotenuse. To solve for hypotenuse, you just need to move your variables. So dapat ang h ara siya sa isa ka side sa equation. So for us to take h, dapat ara siya sa isa ka side pero ara siya sa babaw. Hindi siya denominator. How will we go about that? You have divide h or divided by hypotenuse in one side. So we need to multiply both sides by hypotenuse. And you will get hypotenuse cosine theta is equal to adjacent. Or h cosine theta is equal to a. Okay, nag-multiply na ta. So na-cancel ang h sa isa side. Now, h should only be left in one side. But ang h may ipod siyang cosine theta. So of course, you need to divide both sides by cosine theta. So you will have an equation, h is equal to a divided by cosine theta. The equation becomes h is equal to a divided by cosine theta. Did you understand it or not? And how did we arrive at the equation to solve for h? You can also cross-multiply it. But technically, we do not call it cross-multiplication. Basically, you can just move h to the other side on top. Because when you move around variables, let's say transposition, kung ang variable denominator, or siya sa dalum, mag-cross siya sa equation, or sa equal sign, masailo na siya sa babaw. So this h are siya sa dalom, pag cross yung sa equal sign, masailo na nasa sa babaw. Ang cosine theta are sa babaw, and when you cross it, or if mag-cross siya sa equal sign, it becomes over cosine theta. So that's how you transform equations. Thus, what I've discussed earlier, when we solve for theta, you need to get the inverse sign of your trig functions. And in your calculator, you can just solve for your inverse trig functions. You have the symbols sine raised to negative 1, cosine raised to negative 1, and tangent raised to negative 1. So those are your inverse signs. Or called as arc sine, arc cosine, and arc tangent. Questions so far in trigonometry. Kinanglan nyo lang gid madumduman ang SOHCAHTOA. Sine is sine theta is equal to opposite over hypotenuse. And then cosine, its ratio is adjacent over hypotenuse. And for your tangent, your ratio is opposite over adjacent. Next, of course, the Pythagorean theorem. The Pythagorean theorem is a simplified form of your cosine law. Of course, there are sine and cosine laws, but we will not discuss that anymore. But Pythagorean theorem is applicable to what kind of triangles? Can you use the Pythagorean theorem in any type of triangle? No, we cannot. We can only use the Pythagorean theorem if we have right triangle. So for the Pythagorean theorem, we assign sides with a side A, side B, and side C. And the Pythagorean theorem states that, what's the equation in the Pythagorean theorem? Can you remember the Pythagorean theorem? So the Pythagorean theorem states that the sum of squares of the two sides will be equal to the square of its hypotenuse. Or the square or the hypotenuse is equal to the square root of the sum of squares of the two sides. Or a plus b, a squared plus b squared is equal to c squared. Or c is equal to the square root of a squared plus b squared. So that's your Pythagorean theorem. Now, signs, positives and negatives. In physics, we always have positives and negatives. But the positives and negatives may have a different meaning. In terms of scalar quantities, remember that scalar quantities are quantities that are only described with magnitude. Wala na sila yung direction. But vectors, they have direction. So in terms of scalars, the significance of positive and negatives is just whether you add or subtract a quantity. But however, in vectors, we think of these positives and negatives as if they are on number lines. So when you have a positive number, it means that the quantity is in the positive direction. And if you have negative, then your quantity is in the negative direction. Therefore, positives and negatives in quantities, especially in vectors, are considered as directions. So for example, if you have a vector, which is, for example, velocity, if you have negative 10 meters per second, then what does that mean? What does the negative 10 meters per second? What does it mean? So your negative 10 meters per second means that the velocity is going towards the negative direction. By convention, our negative directions are usually to the left or going down. When you plot it in the Cartesian coordinate plane, negatives are in your negative x-axis and your negative y-axis. So always bear that in mind, the positive and negatives. And when you have your final answers, do not forget your signs because that will indicate direction. Next, of course, we'll be rid of word problems in physics. So in your tenure as physics students, you will be asked to solve word problems and lots of word problems. Word problems are actually notoriously painful. And for good reason, they ask you to think, and thinking is often painful. But if you get good at word problems, they can actually be fun, like a good workout. If you just practice and practice and think that word problems are solvable, then you will enjoy it. Sometimes the hindrance in solving word problems is the prejudice, no? Wala ka pag gani kasugod solve, ginambalan mo na yung mukha o galingon niya, hindi ka kabalo. Or ginambalan mo na yung mukha o galingon niya, kabudlay. So if you set yourself na ay kabudlay, hindi ka kabalo, you will never get to the correct answer. Because at the very beginning, you already barred yourself from getting into the word problem and solving it. So you've got a paragraph in front of you with a lot of labels and numbers. So you're pretty sure there's a vaguely worded question in there. So how do you figure out to solve a word problem? First, draw a picture and label everything. Drawing it is very helpful. This will give you a clear idea of what the situation is, what is happening, and what's to solve for. Even if there is a figure in the book, you can draw your own so that you can mark it up. First, you draw your picture and label it. Second, immediately write all of your defined variables or your given values. Kung ano ang mga values yung dinhatag sa word problems. And it's also important that you watch out for keywords. For example, at rest, in constant motion, maximum height, from the ground. So those are keywords that actually has numerical values that can be interpreted from. Third, you figure out what is required from you in the problem or find out the missing variable. So what is the problem? What does the problem ask us to solve for? This can be really tricky, but ask yourself, if I was the writer of the problem, what should I be asking for? Sometimes, for number three, sometimes the what is asked is explicitly said, like solve for velocity, or solve for the final velocity, solve for the acceleration, solve for the work done. But sometimes it's hidden between the words. So it's also important that you use your mind to understand the words in the problem. Next, you find an equation that consists or that contains all of the known variables. You need to choose the equation that you can use to solve the word problem. So, paano ka maka-arrive at the correct equation? First, the equation should contain all of your variables and your unknown variable. Dapat ara siya sa equation. For most simple word problems, you can find one that will solve the problem. But sometimes in complex or difficult problems, you need to do multiple equations for you to arrive at the final answer. So for example, ang mo given values, you can calculate for a certain value for you to use a certain equation. So first, picture out the problem. Better if you draw a picture. Second, you write off all of your given numbers. Then you identify what is required from you. And then you choose the right equation. Next, once you have the equation that relates to the variables together, solve for the missing variable. Then you now can proceed to your computation. Next, you plug in all the numbers. So tanan mo ang given values, isulod mo to sa variables ang equation, leaving your unknown variable. And remember, for you to solve a variable, your equation must only have one unknown variable. Hindi ka makasolve kung ang equation mo, duwa ang unknown variables. Do not forget your units. So keep all the units. Sometimes you get wrong marks because you leave out your units. It's also important for you to add units in your computation for you to be able to understand and know what expressions can actually be operated together. For example, 3 kilograms divided by 5 meters. Can you operate that? No, because they are of a different unit. Unless you have 10 kilograms divided by 5 kilograms, then they can be operated as 2 kilograms because they have the same unit. And 7, do not forget to box your answer. So graders would really love to know where to look at, especially in your solution box or in your computation area. You have lots of figures and lots of numbers, and it's best that you box your answer so that teachers will not jump into conclusion kung diindang imong final answer. So let's say, for example, a spaceship launches with a constant acceleration after 2 seconds. Or a spaceship launches with a constant acceleration. After 2 seconds, the ship has gone up 6 meters. So what's the acceleration? And what is its velocity at this point? So this is our word problem, a simple word problem actually. So how do we go about this? So one, di ba? First, i-picture out mo siya. So may spaceship ka daw na consistent ang iyang acceleration. And then after 2 seconds, with that acceleration, 6 meters na ang iyan na kadtuan, ang iyang displacement. Next, now we need to write all of the variables. So what are the variables? What are the variables present in the equation? So you have time, which is 2 seconds. What else? What else? You have your distance or displacement, which is 6 meters. What else? Is that it? So you have time, 2 seconds. Displacement, 6 meters. What else? A ship launches with a constant acceleration. What value can you get out of there? Constant acceleration means consistent ang acceleration. At this time, amuni acceleration. At the other time, amuna siya. And the first question actually asks us to solve for acceleration. So therefore, acceleration is not a given variable. But what is the given variable? You have time, 2 seconds, and displacement of 6 meters. Now, picture out, you launch a spaceship. What happens when you launch a spaceship? Anyone? Picture out nyo, ma-launch ka sang spaceship. What happens? It has height. Mm-hmm. So balaan mo nga, pag-launch niya, within 2 seconds, naka 6 meters na siya. Ano pa ang variable? Think. This is important when you solve word problems. Yes, Jeannie, what's with the initial velocity? If you say that initial velocity. Kung we can get the initial velocity out of the word problem, how much is the initial velocity? Anyone? Initial velocity is 0. Nga initial velocity is 0. Nga 0 meters per second ang initial velocity. When you launch a spaceship, of course, from rest siya. Kaya i-launch pa lang gani, di ba? So therefore, here are our variables. Time is 2 seconds. Your displacement or change in position is 6 meters. X is position, by the way. And your initial velocity is 0 meters per second. So that is how important picturing out the problem and understanding the words in the problem is. Because it can give off the variables. Now, kabalo na ito sa variables. What's next? Anong dason? Picture out mo na, na-imagine mo na, na-write off mo na ang given variables. Of course, masolve ka na dahil yun. Kinanglan mo dahil na himaloon. Ano ang kinanglan mo isolve? Ano ang kinanglan mo isolve? We need to solve for acceleration and the velocity at 2 seconds. Generally, we will solve them in sequential order. So now, balanta na ang given, miara naman ta sa required. Next, we should find an equation with all of the variables given and the unknown. So dapat ang equation para ang variable, para man ang unknown. Para ang given variables, para man ang unknown. So for solving acceleration, what will be the best equation to be used among the options there that I'm showing you? For solving acceleration, what will be the best equation to solve for acceleration? If you have time, change in position, and initial velocity. Eat water muna. How do I eat water? Well, so for solving acceleration, what's the best equation? Is it A, B, or C? What should be the equation used? So the equation that should be used is actually equation B. Why? Tell you what, for you to choose an equation, you need to make sure that your unknowns, or your unknown is there, and your given variables. Ang given variable mo, time, change in position, in initial velocity. And you are to solve for A. Ano equation ang may T, may change in position, my initial velocity, my acceleration. That is B. We have there the time, check. Change in position, check. Initial velocity, check. And you have the acceleration. Therefore, you can use equation B to solve for acceleration since you have time, change in position, and initial velocity. Now, how about for solving the velocity? Initial velocity is different from the velocity. Huh? How do we solve for velocity? What equation? Is it A, B, or C? What equation should we use to solve for velocity? So actually, you can use both A and C, but A is much simpler. Mas simple ang equation A. So we can opt for A. But you can use C as well because you have the final velocity, the velocity, you have initial velocity, you have acceleration and change in displacement. Nga may acceleration at tahaw. Kaysa first mga sa first mga problem na i-solve, mabalaan mo na ang acceleration. Therefore, that will be part of your variables already. So to solve for acceleration, to solve for acceleration, we get this kinematic equation. All of those equations, by the way, are called as kinematic equations. You have change in position is equal to initial velocity times time plus 1/2 of acceleration times time squared. And the other equation that we will use is velocity is equal to initial velocity plus acceleration times time. So for solving acceleration, we need change in position is equal to initial velocity times time plus 1/2 a t squared. Now, try to solve for acceleration there. What will be your acceleration? Solve for acceleration. I'll be back. I'll just get water. Okay. So may nakasolve na. If pwede, no, you can you please you want to show your solution, can you please turn on the camera and then just show the paper that you used? Are you practicing there or maybe I'm just assuming? Hello? Tagal niyo naman. So more or less, we'll have this kind of setup when we have our physics classes. Stuck in what, Alira? Anyone who already came up with an answer? So Lindell says it's 3 meters per second. Can you show your solution, Lindell? If you may, or if you refuse, it's fine. Lindell? Hello? Are you alive? Kaliman ko na yan ni Harvey. Can we... Oh, kasadya gin sa inyo mag-online class. Lindel, will you share it? Or maybe Harvey could? Dito kayo ma 2 hours na tabi. Sige ah. So let's show here. How did we solve for acceleration? What's the final answer? It's actually salamat mo answer Linden. The final answer should be 3 meters per second squared. Again, do not forget the units. It's acceleration. So the unit for acceleration is meters per second squared. See? Dila kamo masala sa mga units niyo. Now, since our initial velocity is zero, we can drop V zero times T. Because any number multiplied by zero is zero. So you can just drop that. your displacement, or your change in position, is equal to 1/2 at squared. Now, how do you call it? Transforming your equation, if you have change in position is equal to 1/2 at squared, you just need to have acceleration in one side of the equation. So for you to get rid of 1/2 and t squared together with a, you just need to divide both sides by 1/2 t squared. If you divide both sides by 1/2 t squared, you get acceleration is equal to 2 change in x over t squared, or change in position divided by 1/2 t squared. And then, since you have your transform equation, you can now plug in your number and plug in your variables and solve for the unknown variable. So if you put the change in position is 6 meters and your time is 2 seconds squared, then you get 3 meters per second squared. So that is your acceleration. So nga alaba-alaba din yung solvings. But that is because you may have missed to analyze what are the things that can be dropped off in the equation. Since zero siya, so zero. Any number multiplied by zero is zero, right? So your acceleration is 3 meters per second squared. Question, naiintindihan ba ini? Basically, most of our problems will look like this one. Now, we have solved for the first unknown variable. Next, we need to solve for velocity. And to solve for velocity, if we look back, ang ating nagamitan na equation is velocity is equal to initial velocity plus a times time. Now, initial velocity again is zero, right? So if v initial is zero, then you can just drop that out. Then you're left with velocity is equal to a times time. So if your acceleration is 3 meters per second squared and your time is 2 seconds, then you get velocity is 6 meters per second. So that's how you deal with word problems. Questions. So of course, just a reminder to everyone to practice, and practice, because that will help you in doing good and doing well in your physics class. Consistent practice. So that's how to succeed in Physics 1. So see you next week virtually through our Schoology platforms. And I hope that we get to have a wonderful and fruitful school year. So thank you very much and have a great day. Wow, halos tatlong oras tayo dito. Thank you very much, everyone.